This is side 18 of Tumultuous Times by Father Francisco Radecki and Father Dominic Radecki. George Nevers is your reader for this section. We'll continue reading on page 387. The canon, the heart of the Mass. The canon of the Mass, as preserved in the Tridentine Latin Mass, was essentially composed by Christ himself. It is most pleasing to God and is truly his work. Francis Amio asserts that the canon was written before the Gospels. The text of the Roman canon does not entirely resemble any of the four accounts of the institution of the Eucharist in the New Testament. It represents, very possibly, an even older tradition. The Eucharist had already been celebrated for something like a quarter of a century when in 55 or 56 A.D., St. Paul wrote his account of the Lord's Supper in his first letter to the Corinthians. Joseph Huslein, S.J., says that the early church fathers taught that Christ himself had personally instructed his apostles in regard to that entire portion of the Mass, which in the early church was known as the Eucharistic prayer, but in the Eastern church it corresponds to the anaphora, and in the West, to the preface and the canon combined. Father Gassner, OSB, continues, "The canon had its history, development, changes, reforms, until it became the unchangeable rule of offering the Eucharistic sacrifice. Not so the words of consecration. Our Lord's words remained unchanged in the Eucharistic rite from the time when the first canon was written, even from the time before any canon and any gospel were written, from the Eucharistic celebration of the apostles to our own days. This stability of the words of Christ around which the prayers of the canon grew up were unfolded like rose leaves round a shining diamond, is in itself a most solemn testimony for the perennial faith of the Church, that with the words of Christ and exclusively through them, transubstantiation is accomplished." Introduction of St. Joseph in the Canon. Beginning in 1815, hundreds of thousands of signatures of clergy and laity were sent to the Vatican requesting permission to insert the name of St. Joseph into the canon of the Mass. One of the reasons assigned for making the request was because many persons had a particular devotion to the saint. The Sacred Congregation of Rites steadfastly refused to grant the petition. Even though the addition of St. Joseph's name would not be an essential change, the Church remained firm in her refusal, which was binding throughout the world. So careful is the Church to prevent innovations from entering into this part of the Mass that she forbids anyone to meddle with it under pain of incurring her most severe censures. The campaign to promote this change became quite intense, even just prior to Vatican II. Monsignor Joseph Phelan of St. Joseph's Church in Capitola, California, launched a drive which netted 150,000 signatures. It didn't take the modernists long to use this seemingly innocent request to the benefit of their devious purpose. Long before the council, booklets containing a petition were circulated to the council fathers. The modernists, under the guise of promoting devotion to St. Joseph, soon became actively involved in this movement to include St. Joseph in the communicantes of the Mass. The insertion of St. Joseph would serve as a wedge to break open the canon and authorize change to the very words of the consecration, the modernists' ultimate target. The Cardinal Secretary of State on November 13, 1962, announced to the Council that John XXIII had decided to insert the name of St. Joseph in the canon of the Mass immediately after the name of the Most Holy Virgin. John XXIII had taken this independent action while the Second Vatican Council was in session. This was indeed a bold move, because no changes had been made to the canon of the Mass since the time of Pope St. Gregory I, 590 to 604 A.D. However, even he made no essential changes, but only minor ones. The whole canon in its present structure was already in existence before Pope Gregory I. His additions are Dies quae nostras in tua pace disponas, and provide that our days be spent in thy peace, inserted in the Hanc Igitur prayer, which he ordained as a regular prayer, the addition of the names of the saints Matthias, Barnabas, Agatha, and Lucia, and the rearrangement in hierarchical order. Pope St. Pius V, 1566 to 1572 A.D., threatened with the wrath of Almighty God and the Apostles Peter and Paul anyone who would dare to change the Mass in any substantial way. The liturgical modernists ignored this perilous warning, disregarded tradition, history, and the work of Christ, and attempted to change the unchangeable, the fixed rule, the canon of the Mass. A revolution was unleashed that would culminate with the creation of the new Mass, Novus Ordo Missae. Suppression of the Last Gospel. Ominous clouds appeared at the advent of Vatican II when John XXIII ordered changes to be made to the church calendar, the divine office, and the Mass. These changes, which went into effect on January 1, 1961, decreed the preparatory prayers at the foot of the altar are to be omitted on a few occasions during the year. The creed is not to be said or sung as frequently as before. The words Benedicamus Domino are to be used for the dismissal at Mass only when the Mass is followed by a procession. The Last Gospel is omitted in sung funeral Masses and whenever a procession follows the Mass. Additional prayers or commemorations and collects are strictly limited in number. At sung Masses, the celebrant does not recite the Epistle and the Gospel, which are chanted by the subdeacon and the deacon, respectively. 3 years later, in the Vatican's first instruction on the implementation of the Constitution of the Sacred Liturgy Inter Ecumenicae, the modernists advised that the destruction of the Mass and sacraments should be carried out cautiously. The general reform of the liturgy will be better received by the faithful if it is accomplished gradually and if it is proposed and explained to them properly by their pastors. The shrewd modernists introduced many seemingly minor liturgical changes in order to condition Catholics to accept the eventual fundamental changes in doctrine that would follow. In Inter Ecumenicae, the Vatican declared, the Last Gospel is omitted, the Leonine prayers are suppressed. The term Last Gospel refers to a section of St. John's Gospel that is recited at the conclusion of Mass, the first 14 verses of Chapter 1. These scriptural verses are also used in the rite of exorcism. Ironically, the suppression of the Last Gospel is in direct contradiction to the liturgical constitution of Vatican II. Quote, sacred scripture is of the greatest importance in the celebration of the liturgy. Hence, in order to achieve the restoration, progress, and adaptation of the sacred liturgy, it is essential to promote that warm and lively appreciation of sacred scripture to which the venerable tradition of Eastern and Western rites gives testimony. End quote. Liberals suppressed the Last Gospel not only because it contains an explicit profession of faith in the divinity of Christ, but also because it contains the unecumenical phrase, "He came into his own, and his own received him not." Other changes in the Mass. The first use of the vernacular in the Mass occurred when the Vatican decreed on April 24, 1964, that the priests say the words Corpus Christi, Body of Christ, in the vernacular as he distributed Holy Communion. The communicant was to respond, Amen. Additional changes to the Mass were introduced gradually and craftily. By November 29, 1964, all the parishes in the United States had begun to pray the portions of the Mass in the official interim missal in English. By March 7, 1965, the Commission on the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy, the 40-member concilium, told us that the liturgy of the Word, that is, the early instructional part of the Mass, was to be celebrated away from the altar. Tables replace altars. Early changes eventually escalated into major ones. The sanctuary was rearranged, replacing the altar with a table at which the priest now faced the congregation. Craftily, liturgists claimed that they were reviving the practice of the early church. In reality, it was a revival of exactly what had taken place during the Protestant Reformation and was the very thing that Pope Pius XII had warned against. Monsignor Hughes describes how, in an earlier century, altars were removed from the churches and tables placed in their stead. On November 24, 1550, the King's Council in England ordered all the altars to be destroyed. Every parish was now to provide a table of wood, and on communion days this was to be used by the minister. The council issued with these orders an official explanation which makes crystal clear the nature of the official changes since 1547. The form of the table shall move the simple from the superstitious opinions of the popish mass unto the right use of the Lord's Supper. For the use of an altar is to make sacrifice upon it. The use of a table is to serve men to eat upon it. Over 415 years later, these same changes were implemented by Vatican II under the semblance of a valid council. This innovation 30 years ago entailed an architectural revolution and radically changed attitudes to the celebration of the Eucharist throughout the Catholic world. The altar was detached from the apse. The priest no longer turned his back on the people, but faced them. According to German liturgist Klaus Gamber, this was totally wrong and should be corrected. It was thought that by doing this they revived a custom of primitive Christianity, writes Gamber in the posthumous translation of his book, but it can be proven beyond all doubt that there never was a celebration versus populum, facing the people, in the Eastern or the Western Church, and that at all times everyone, priests and faithful, were turned toward the east to pray ad dominum to the Lord, towards the east, the place where salvation was manifest. Priest and people should face in the same direction, toward the altar, toward God, especially for acts of prayer and sacrifice directed toward God. When Mass is so celebrated, the priest is at the head of the people, leading them, as it were, expressing by his position the part he takes in divine worship. Church architecture. Pope St. Pius X explains the two ends of the liturgy as being the glory of God and the sanctification and edification of the faithful. Catholic cathedrals and churches throughout the world prior to Vatican II contributed to both these ends. One of the oldest terms used to describe the Christian church is porta coeli, the gate of heaven. The Gothic cathedrals of Cologne, Germany, and Amiens, France, embody this concept in a wonderful manner as colored light streams through their stained glass windows, illuminating the breathtaking vaulted ceilings, delicately carved high altar, and the beautiful depictions of the saints. Medieval cathedrals were often called the poor man's Bible, since the message of Christ and biblical themes were depicted in glass and stone to instruct the common people about the faith. G. Colton, in his book Art and the Reformation, tells us, "In many ways, therefore, churchman and artist were natural allies, and art was kept in natural touch, both with the religious idealist up above and with popular ideas down below. These magnificent works of art were often constructed in a cruciform shape in order to remind the faithful of the sacrifice of Christ on Calvary." In his book, Heaven in Stone and Glass, Robert Barron sheds light upon the architectural features of the great cathedrals. What we spontaneously call the front of a cathedral, the facade and towers, is in fact the back. Almost all the Gothic cathedrals are oriented, that is to say, they face the rising sun, and the eastern point of these churches is not the facade, but the apse. When the medieval priest celebrated Mass, he was situated in the apsidal end of the cathedral, and he looked to the east, away from the people and the main portals. This orientation was of great spiritual moment, for all of Christian life is a looking to the one who called himself the light of the world. The cathedral also personifies the battle between God and Satan. But when we turn toward something, we inevitably turn away from something also. To set our face is also to set our back. Therefore, the backside of the cathedral symbolizes the Christian resistance to all that is opposed to the light of Christ. If the apse faces the rising sun, the facade confronts the setting sun and all the powers of darkness. It is the church's great no to violence, self-absorption, and hatred, all the works of the devil. And this, of course, is why there is a fierce, bristling, looming quality to so many of the Gothic fronts. They are the fighting face of Christianity. Since Vatican II, all this has radically changed. A prominent Catholic architect, for example, says that churches are a thing of the past, and it's not the church that's needed, it's the community center. Why are so many modern churches so barren or even ominous? Consider the recently constructed $195 million Los Angeles Cathedral. Some critics have compared the cathedral's austere modernist look to a prison. David Littlejohn described the new cathedral in the September 11, 2002 issue of the Wall Street Journal. The 5.5-acre cathedral precinct stands on a small rise just on the edge of the Hollywood Freeway. So thousands of people will see it from the outside every day, and they will probably be disappointed by what they see. The blue construction fence has been replaced by an unwelcoming tan concrete wall. The shapes that rise over it, with the possible exception of a freestanding 150-foot-tall bell tower on the edge of the freeway, and a gigantic cross in a box, illuminated at night like a Las Vegas hotel sign, cannot be called inspiring. The cathedral itself, 128 feet tall, colored in beigey tan, chopped into odd angles, and decorated with horizontal stripes, is hard to comprehend from a distance. Changing the unchangeable Mass. The holy sacrifice of the Mass was established by Christ himself and is therefore an indispensable part of the Catholic faith. It is not just a ceremony that can be changed arbitrarily every few years. To change any of its essential elements is synonymous with the destruction of the rite in its entirety. This is what happened during the Reformation when Martin Luther did away with the canon of the Mass and made the words of consecration and institution part of the distribution of communion. Ironically, these same changes have been made after Vatican II. Clearly, this change destroyed the Roman Mass. Even though it appeared that traditional liturgical forms continued unchanged, initially even the vestments and choral chant remained. Monsignor Klaus Gomber also noted that unlike the appalling changes we are currently witnessing, the changes made in the Roman Missal over a period of almost 1,400 years did not involve the rite itself. Rather, they were changes concerned only with the addition and enrichment of new feast days, mass formulas, and certain prayers. The use of deception. Although the argument is used over and over again by the people responsible for creating the new mass, they cannot claim that what they have done is what the majority of the Council Fathers actually wanted. The instructions given by the Liturgy Commission were general in nature, and they opened up many possible ways for implementing what the Commission stipulated. But the one statement we can make with certainty is that new Ordo of the Mass that has now emerged would not have been endorsed by the Council Fathers. Certain stipulations were included in the Constitution on the Liturgy to imply that the holy sacrifice of the Mass would not be drastically altered. Number 4, in faithful obedience to tradition, the Sacred Council declares that Holy Mother Church holds all lawfully recognized rites to be of equal right and dignity, that she wishes to preserve them in the future and to foster them in every way. The Council also desires that, where necessary, the rites be revised carefully in the light of sound tradition, and that they be given new vigor to meet present-day circumstances and needs. Number 23. In order that sound tradition be retained, there must be no innovations unless the good of the Church genuinely and certainly requires them, and care must be taken that any new forms adopted should in some way grow organically from forms already existing. 36.1. The use of the Latin language with due respect to particular law is to be preserved in the Latin rites. Number 114. The treasury of sacred music is to be preserved and cultivated with great care. Number 116. The Church recognizes Gregorian chant as being specially suited to the Roman liturgy. Therefore, it should be given pride of place in liturgical services. The modernists knew full well that this was merely for the sake of deception. All these laudatory guidelines were summarily rejected as the new liturgical changes were introduced. The formulation of a new Mass. Once the clergy had been desensitized to change, Paul VI proceeded to ignore these passages and replace the holy sacrifice of the Mass with a new Mass, or Novus Ordo Missae. On January 3, 1964, Paul VI commissioned Father Annibal Bugnini to work with a group of advisors, the Concilium, to create the new Mass. Bugnini said, "We must strip from our Catholic liturgy everything that can be the shadow of a stumbling block for our separated brethren, that is, the Protestants." Later, allegations of Father Bugnini's affiliation with Freemasonry became known. This accusation was made public in April 1976 by Tito Cassini, one of Italy's leading Catholic writers. The accusation was repeated in other journals and gained credence as the months passed, and the Vatican did not intervene to deny the allegations. Subsequently, Bugnini served as apostolic pro nuncio to Iran from 1976 to 1982. Paul VI chose six Protestant ministers: Raymond George, Ronald Jasper, Massey Shepherd, Friedrich Kuneth, Eugene Brand, and Max Thorian, to assist Bugnini in composing a new Mass which would be acceptable to Protestants and non-Catholics. This special commission became known as the Concilium for the Implementation of the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy. The head of the Concilium was the liberal Cardinal Lurcaro, whom Cardinal Antonio Bacci described as Luther resurrected. The fact that Protestants collaborated in formulating the new Mass was confirmed by an article in the Detroit News entitled, "Protestants Helped Revamp Catholic Mass," Priest says. Protestant scholars, including an American Episcopalian, have had a voice in recent changes in the Catholic Mass and other liturgy. It was revealed today by the leading American spokesman on church unity. Monsignor William W. Baum of Washington told delegates to the General Synod of the United Church of Christ that the Papal Concilium on Liturgical Reform has turned to Protestant theologians and liturgists who sit in regularly on meetings. In a private interview, Monsignor Baum said, "The Protestant liturgical scholars at the Vatican represent the World Anglican Communion, the Lutheran World Federation, and the World Council of Churches." The Anglican representative, he said, is Dr. Massey Shepherd, California liturgist and professor at the Church Divinity School of the Pacific at Berkeley. "I think this development is highly significant, but it has been overlooked," said Monsignor Baum. They were not simply there as observers, but as consultants as well. And they participate fully in the discussions on Catholic liturgical renewal. It wouldn't mean much if they just listened, but they contribute. The fact that six non-Catholic ministers were allowed to create a new Mass for the Catholic Church is so absurd it is difficult to believe that this was actually done. It would be just as ridiculous to entertain the idea for even a moment that the Protestant churches, or any other church for that matter, would allow a group of six traditional Catholic liturgists to write a new worship service for their religion. Nevertheless, Protestant collaboration in the formulation of the new Mass is a documented fact. This alone reveals the heretical nature of Vatican II. The French philosopher, secretary and confidant of Paul VI, Jean Guiton, revealed in a radio interview in the mid-1990s, "The intention of Paul VI with regard to what is commonly called the Mass was to reform the Catholic liturgy in such a way that it should almost coincide with the Protestant liturgy. But what is curious is that Paul VI did that to get as close as possible to the Protestant Lord's Supper. There was, with Paul VI, an ecumenical intention to remove, correct, or at least relax what was too Catholic in the traditional sense in the Mass, and, I repeat, to get the Catholic Mass closer to the Calvinist Mass." What has become of those responsible for the creation and promulgation of the new Mass? The reformers of Vatican II have sealed their own fate, for in the papal bull Quo Primum, Pope St. Pius V condemned such persons with the wrath of Almighty God and the Apostles Peter and Paul. Comparison between the Latin Mass and the New Mass. Paul Bernier explains the sacrificial nature of the Mass and the meal aspect of the Novus Ordo in his book, Eucharist, Celebrating Its Rhythm in Our Lives. Before the Second Vatican Council, the Eucharist, the holy sacrifice of the Mass, was conceived as essentially a ritual performed by the priest as a sacrificial personage, much after the model of Old Testament priests. This sacrificial role was exercised especially during the Eucharistic prayer, the canon of the Mass, which, as proper to the priest, was said silently. Such a Eucharist stressed the vertical relationship between God and creation and the adoration owed to God on the part of His creatures. In contrast to this emphasis on Eucharist as eternal sacrifice, The days following the council began to see a greater emphasis placed on the horizontal dimension of the Eucharist. In rediscovering the meal aspects of the liturgy, with the appropriate awareness of the interrelatedness of people gathered around a common table, the Mass became a celebration and expression of fellowship. New Ecumenical Lectionary. The Lectionary is a new ecumenical liturgical book published shortly after Vatican II. It contains the scriptural readings for Sundays and weekdays that are used for the new Mass. The Lectionary was the result of several years' work by a full-time staff and 800 consultants, Protestants, Catholics, and Jews, who brought it to its present form. Episcopalians, BCP, pages 888 to 931, Lutherans, LBW, pages 13 to 41, and Presbyterians, WB, pages 167 to 175, have made their own version of it. Because Catholics, Jews, and Protestants differ on important issues, God, the Bible, worship, sin, salvation, saints, sacraments, justification, the Holy Eucharist, etc., numerous scriptural passages were altered in order to accommodate the beliefs of these religions. The lectionary is built on a 3-year cycle and liturgical calendar that is used jointly by Protestants and post-conciliar Catholics. The post-conciliar Church has eliminated the seasons of Pentecost and Epiphany and replaced them with the generic Sundays in ordinary time. Invalid matter in the new Mass. Wheaten bread and grape wine are the essential matter for the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist. For validity, the bread must be made from wheat mixed with natural water, baked by the application of fire heat, including electric cooking, and substantially uncorrupted. Bread made with milk, wine, oil, etc., either entirely or in a notable part, is invalid matter. For licity, lawfulness, the bread must be of wheat flour, and only in case of necessity, a white material thrashed or crushed from wheat. It must be unmixed with any other substance besides wheat flour and water. It is gravely unlawful to consecrate with doubtful matter. In the Oriental Eastern rites of the Church, the minister is gravely bound to use leavened bread, except the Armenians and Maronites who use unleavened bread. Latin priests must use only unleavened bread. The Congregation of Sacred Rites declared, "Therefore, the valid matter of this sacrament must be, in the common estimation of men, bread made from wheat and not mixed notably with something else so that it is no longer wheat." Nevertheless, Pope John Paul II has permitted bread to be replaced by cakes made of millet or cassava root, grape wine by corn wine. Concerning this obvious repudiation of divine law, Father Francis Fenton has written, "The Church's teaching is crystal clear on the subject of what constitutes valid matter for the holy sacrifice of the Mass, and no one may make any substantive change of that matter without invalidating the Mass. To suppose that an authentic pope would render invalid the very consecration of the Mass, is not this totally contrary to the most elementary common sense? Is not such a supposition utterly absurd? Assuredly it is, and no theological expertise whatsoever is required to arrive at that conclusion." Various ingredients are used for altar breads in modern Catholic churches today with seemingly little regard for validity and lawfulness. Recipes for altar breads found on the Internet include brown sugar, buttermilk, honey, molasses, oil, shortening, wheat germ, and bisquick. Eucharistic meal replaces the holy sacrifice of the Mass. At first, the true intentions of the modernists were couched under the pretense that they were merely translating the Latin liturgy into the vernacular. However, if liturgical reform meant that the Tridentine Latin Mass was merely to be translated into the vernacular, Catholic linguists, not Protestant ministers, should have overseen the project. In reality, even this wasn't needed, for the Latin Mass had already been translated into most of the vernacular languages and printed in missals and prayer books. Cardinal James McIntyre noted that prior to Vatican II, very many of the faithful read the whole Mass assiduously and privately with the help of missals. These missals are written either in the vernacular or with the Latin on the same page. However, the modernists never intended to accurately translate the Mass into the vernacular, nor even to paraphrase it. Their real intent was to create a totally new ecumenical service. Paul VI was determined to destroy the holy sacrifice of the Mass. This is evident in his official definition of the new Mass. The Lord's Supper is the assembly or gathering together of the people of God, with a priest presiding to celebrate the memorial of the Lord. For this reason, the promise of Christ is particularly true of a local congregation of the Church. Where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in their midst. Matthew 18:20. Since this definition explicitly denies the sacrificial character of the Mass, it was amended by Paul VI because of numerous protests made by Catholics throughout the world. The Lord's Supper or Mass gathers together the people of God with a priest presiding in the person of Christ to celebrate the memorial of the Lord or Eucharistic sacrifice. The liturgical reformers thus rejected the sacrificial nature of the Mass in favor of a memorial meal or celebration. The new Eucharistic prayers, which have replaced the canon of the Mass, are a mere narrative of the Last Supper. The new Mass is, all told, a simplification so sweeping as to signal a veritable revolution in the spirit of our public worship as well as in its practice. In spite of the objection of the majority of the First General Assembly of the 1967 Synod of Bishops, Paul VI continued its development. In his work, The Reform of the Roman Liturgy, Monsignor Klaus Gomber writes, "In spite of the careful advance work that had already been done and the skilled manipulation and management of the sessions themselves, the First General Assembly of the 1967 Synod of Bishops did not approve, with the required two-thirds majority vote, the so-called Missa Normativa, the forerunner of the new Novus Ordo Missae. Even so, the development of the new Ordo Missae continued anyway." In his study of the Novus Ordo Missae, Cardinal Alfredo Ottaviani, former prefect of the Holy Office, states, "To abandon a liturgical tradition which for four centuries stood as a sign and pledge of unity in worship, and to replace it with another liturgy, which, due to the countless liberties it implicitly authorized, cannot be but a sign of division, a liturgy which teems with insinuations or manifest errors against the integrity of the Catholic faith, is, we feel, bound in conscience to proclaim an incalculable error." He further declares that the new Mass represents, both as a whole and in its details, a striking departure from the Catholic theology of the Mass as it was formulated in Session 22 of the Council of Trent. The modernists, nevertheless, continued with their agenda. It did not take them long to attack the very heart and essence of the Mass itself, Christ's words of consecration. Transubstantiation. Transubstantiation is the miracle that took place at the Last Supper and is repeated during the consecration of the Mass, whereby the bread and wine are changed into the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ. The Council of Florence declared that transubstantiation takes place during Mass when the priest uses the proper matter and material, form, words, and intention. Each is essential for the validity of the sacrament. The words of the Savior by which he instituted this sacrament are the form of this sacrament, for the priest speaking in the person of Christ effects this sacrament. For by the power of the very words, the substance of the bread is changed into the body of Christ, and the substance of the wine into the blood, yet in such a way that Christ is contained entire under the species of bread and entire under the species of wine. Transubstantiation does not take place in the Mass if the matter, form, or intention are essentially changed. The bread and wine remain merely bread and wine. This is explained by St. Thomas Aquinas, 1226 to 1274. Now it is clear, if any substantial part of the sacramental form be suppressed, that the essential sense of the words is destroyed, and consequently the sacrament is invalid. The great doctor of the Church, St. Alphonsus Liguori, 1696 to 1787, asserted, "If anyone abbreviates or changes something of the form of consecration, and the words do not signify the same thing, he does not confect the sacrament." The De Defectibus Decree, which is found in every Roman Missal published prior to Vatican II, is almost identical to the wording of this passage. This decree explains in minute detail that defective matter, bread and wine, form, words of consecration, minister, or intention, invalidates the Mass. The decree further says, "If he, the priest, should add anything which would not change the meaning, he would indeed confect, but would sin gravely." The form required for the validity of the sacrament is found not only in the De Defectibus Decree of the Missale Romanum, but also in the Catechism of the Council of Trent. Our worship reflects our beliefs. This truth is expressed by the idiom, lex orandi, lex credendi, the law of praying is the law of believing. Therefore, the post-conciliar Church had to destroy the holy sacrifice of the Mass because it contradicted the heresies of ecumenism and modernism and was a significant obstacle to the formation of a one-world Church. The Consecration of the Host. When our Lord instituted the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist at the Last Supper, he used the words, "For this is my body," to consecrate the host. The new reformers, following the example of Martin Luther, added the words, "which will be given for you," to this formula. It may seem to be an insignificant change, but there was a specific reason for the alteration. The traditional words of consecration denote an event that is taking place here and now. The new terminology denotes a future event and leaves room for various interpretations. This would also explain why the blessing of the offerings prior to the consecration was dropped by the Episcopalians, Lutherans, and the Reformers of Vatican II. In the true Mass, the priest asks Almighty God that the bread and wine may become for our good the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. These words were far too explicit for the modernists and ecumenists, so they conveniently discarded them. The consecration of the wine. The essential words necessary for a valid consecration of the wine are, "Hic est enim calix sanguinis mei, Novi et Eterni Testamenti Mysterium Fidei qui pro vobis et pro multis effunditur in remissionem peccatorem. For this is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal covenant, the mystery of faith, which shall be shed for you and for many unto the forgiveness of sins. The De Defectivis decree states clearly, if one should take away from or change anything of the form of the consecration of the body and of the blood, and in the very change of the words should not mean the same thing, he would not confect the sacrament. St. Thomas Aquinas explains why our Lord used the words for many at the Last Supper. The blood of Christ's passion has its efficacy not merely among the elect among the Jews to whom the blood of the Old Testament was exhibited, but also for the Gentiles, not only for the priests who confect the sacrament or others who receive and partake, but likewise for those whom it is offered. And therefore he says expressly, for you, the Jews, and for many, namely the Gentiles, or for those who partake, and for many for whom it is offered. The Catechism of the Council of Trent specifically defines the form of the Holy Eucharist in order to guard against shameful mistakes on the part of priests at the time of consecration due to ignorance of the form. We are then firmly to believe that it, the form of the consecration of the wine, consists in the following words, "This is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith which shall be shed for you and for many to the remission of sins." Of these words, the greater part are taken from Scripture, but some have been preserved in the Church from apostolic tradition. It is plain that no other words constitute the form. With reason, therefore, were the words for all not used, as in this place the fruits of the passion are alone spoken of, and to the elect only did his passion bring the fruit of salvation. On April 3, 1969, Paul VI promulgated the new Mass in his apostolic constitution, Missale Romanum. Note that the words for the consecration of the wine have been essentially changed in the vernacular translations of the new Mass. In every Eucharistic prayer, therefore, we wish these words to be as follows. Over the bread, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you. Over the wine, take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all men, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. The words, the mystery of faith, spoken by the priest, are to be taken out of the context of the words spoken by our Lord and used instead to introduce an acclamation by the faithful. When Paul VI replaced Christ's words for many with the words for all, he changed the essential words of the consecration of the Mass. Our Lord died for the salvation of all, but his passion and death were efficacious only for the many who are saved. In other words, Christ redeemed all, but not all are saved. This is what is signified in the true words of consecration. St. Alphonsus Liguori says, the words pro vobis et pro multis, for you and for many, are used to distinguish the virtue of the blood of Christ from its fruits. For the blood of Christ is of sufficient value to save all men, but its fruits are applicable only to a certain number and not to all, and this is their own fault. If Christ wanted to use the words for all at the Last Supper, he would have done so, since the Aramaic language has words that mean all the inhabitants of the earth, or all mankind. Obviously, he chose to use the word many, the word that the Catholic Church has retained in her liturgy for nearly 2,000 years. Our Lord's words that his precious blood would be shed for you, the apostles, and for many, have always been understood to refer to the efficacy and not the sufficiency of his sacrifice. Since the new form, the faulty translation, contains a lie and a sacrilegious mutation of the words of Christ as recorded in Holy Writ and Scripture, how can it conceivably be a valid form for this most holy of sacraments? Invalid form. The Protestant liturgies created by the reformers of the 16th century were invalid due to defect of form since they changed the wording. Isn't it paradoxical that the new Mass, which was drafted after Vatican II, employs the same changes made by the Protestants? Is it possibly because six Protestant ministers were active in its creation? Would it not follow that the masses and consecrations used in post-conciliar churches are also invalid due to defect of form? Shortly after the conclusion of the Second Vatican Council, a new Mass, the Novus Ordo Missae, was formulated, in which substantial changes were made to the words of consecration. These essential changes have rendered the new Mass invalid, as stated by the Catechism of the Council of Trent, the De Defectibus Decree of Pope St. Pius V, and by St. Thomas Aquinas and St. Alphonsus Liguori. Therefore, because the matter, form, and or intention of the Mass were essentially changed, transubstantiation does not take place. The elements remain merely bread and wine. Knowing full well that the changes made to the words of consecration were in complete contradiction to the words of Christ and the teachings of the Church, Paul VI nevertheless promulgated the new Mass. In one of the greatest deceptions ever perpetrated, Paul VI misled millions of Catholics into believing that the new Mass was simply a vernacular translation of the Tridentine Mass. In order to couch his deception, Paul VI even went so far as to retain the correct form of the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist to the point of including the words pro multis, for many, in the Latin translation of his apostolic constitution, Missale Romanum. Paul VI ordered his liturgical commissions to translate the new Mass into the vernacular with the foreknowledge that he would reserve to himself the power to approve directly all the translations into the vernacular of the sacramental forms. Even though the official Latin words pro multis can only be correctly interpreted as for many, it is not surprising, knowing Paul VI's obvious intentions, to find that in every vernacular translation of the new Mass, the official Vatican-approved words for the consecration of the wine were substantially altered to the translation, for you and for all men, and later to for you and for all. Thus, our Lord's own words, for many, were insidiously replaced with for all. Paul VI officially decreed that on March 22, 1972, the Novus Ordo Missae became mandatory throughout the world. It is unthinkable that a true pope could promulgate an invalid Mass containing such obvious doctrinal errors. He tried to soften the blow by saying that Catholics should prepare themselves to be disturbed by these changes, adding that pious people will be those most greatly disturbed. If everything, including the Council, were good, true, and valid, then why would the pious be disturbed? Are not the words, "This is my body, this is my blood," alone sufficient? Regarding the words of consecration, Father Suarez says that according to the common opinion of theologian, not merely the words of the form, "This is the chalice of my blood," but all the words from take to remission of sins were pronounced by Jesus Christ. Concerning the necessity of the complete form for the validity of the sacrament, St. Thomas Aquinas has written, "Some have maintained that the words, 'This is the chalice of my blood,' alone belong to the substance of the form, but not the words which follow. Now, this seems incorrect, because the words which follow them are determinations of the predicate, that is, of Christ's blood. Consequently, they belong to the integrity of the expression. Some theologians hold the opinion that 'this is my body, this is my blood' constitute the essential form of the Holy Eucharist. However, despite the speculative opinions of theologians, in practice, the minister of a sacrament may never use a probable form. He must always use a certainly valid form, not a doubtful one. In practice, the very raising of questions or doubts about the validity of a given manner of confecting a sacrament, if this question is based on an apparent defect of matter or form, would necessitate the strict abstention from use of that doubtful manner of performing the sacramental act until the doubts are resolved. In confecting the sacraments, all priests are obliged to follow the medium certum, that is, the safer course." Father Joan reaffirms this in his Moral Theology when he says, "Matter and form must be certainly valid. Hence, one may not follow a probable opinion and use either doubtful matter or form." This fact is supported by Father Henry Davis, S.J. "In conferring the sacraments, as also in the consecration in Mass, it is never allowed to adopt a probable course of action as to validity and to abandon the safer course. The contrary was explicitly condemned by Pope Innocent XI, 1670-76. To do so would be a grievous sin against religion, namely an act of irreverence towards what Christ our Lord has instituted. It would be a grievous sin against charity, as the recipient would probably be deprived of the graces and effects of the sacrament. It would be a grievous sin against justice, as the recipient has a right to valid sacraments." Is not one valid consecration sufficient? Father Bray asks several weighty questions. Even if the consecration of the wine is invalid by reason of defect of form, and therefore the entire Mass is invalid, does the priest nevertheless truly consecrate the bread in such a Mass? Even if the wine does not become truly consecrated, would we not at least have validly consecrated hosts, the true Eucharistic body of Christ, provided that the consecration of the bread be performed using the proper matter and form? And therefore, could not our people at least be certain they are receiving the true body and blood of Jesus at communion time in such a Mass? The answer to these questions is a qualified no, for one could not be certain that the hosts are truly consecrated. At least there is a real and practical doubt. In fact, some theologians hold with certainty that under such circumstances, the bread is not validly consecrated. Father M. Gavin, S.J., explains, "The consecration, according to our Lord's command, must ever be under both kinds, since it is only from the double consecration that the Blessed Eucharist has the character of a sacrifice. The separate consecration of bread and wine represents in a mystical way the death of Christ, the parting of the body, and blood on the cross. That blood was shed really on the cross, mystically in the institution of the Eucharist and daily at Mass on our altars. Since the Holy Eucharist is a sacrament and a sacrifice, the consecration of both species is required. This is confirmed by the moralists Nolden and Schmidt. As often as the sacrifice is offered, the consecration of both species is required according to the will and institution of Christ. For Christ at the Last Supper, consecrating each species, commanded, "Do this in commemoration of me." The very notion of sacrifice demands the consecration of both species. Father Adolphe Tanqueray writes, "The consecration of both species is required by divine law for the essence of the sacrifice. This we know from Christ's very words of institution and from the precept and practice of the Church, so that it is necessary in order that a true representation of the sacrifice of the cross be had." Father Bray continues, "The sacrament of the body and blood of the Lord was given to us only and exclusively in the context of the sacrifice of the body and blood of Christ. If no sacrifice, then no sacrament. Nor is there any indication anywhere that Christ willed the sacrament of the Eucharist to be confected apart from the propitiatory sacrifice of the Mass. Indeed, the notion of the sacrament in the Eucharist according to the will of Christ cannot be separated from the notion of sacrifice. Indeed, in practice, Church law absolutely forbids, without any exception, the consecration of only one species without the other. Canon 817 of the Code of Canon Law states, it is forbidden, even in extreme cases of necessity, to consecrate one species without the other. The Roman Missal, in its section De Defectibus, prescribes that a Mass interrupted after the consecration of the host because of illness or death of the celebrant must be continued by another priest, that is, that the wine must be consecrated to complete and effect the sacrifice." This is the end of side 18, continued on side 19.